Thank you, Hossein, and the entire NANOC program committee for inviting me to speak. I feel very privileged to have the chance to speak in front of you all. I'm even more privileged to have learned the contents of this talk from one of the most fantastically talented teams in the world. Any insights that I'm able to convey, really how we have them to thank. I'm really acting as the mouthpiece for them here today. So today I'm going to be telling you about availability. And how we think about availability, how I think about availability in our networks in particular, though the lessons apply more generally to our overall infrastructure across computing, across storage, and in networking. Networking, in my perhaps biased opinion, is the hardest of the three. We'll talk about why. We have the biggest responsibility in terms of availability. And also, going to Hossein's point, I think there's a lot of history in terms of how the networking community, myself included, think about availability. So I'll cover this in a three-part arc. I'll start with a little bit of history. I'll then go into how we do networking, broadly speaking. I won't go into the details here at Google. And then I'll go into the details of one of our worst outages, actually a low point for me personally. But also a great learning opportunity. I think one of the things that we do well at Google is we treat these sorts of failures as an opportunity to learn and to take action. So I'll summarize both the failure that we suffered, but also some of the principles that we've extracted from this and other failures, less spectacular failures, over the years to guide the design of our systems moving forward. Okay, so first with history. I'm a huge student of history, huge fan, and so I'll very briefly go through how I think we wound up here, and it will actually have implications for how we think about availability as well, as we'll shortly see. So I could start arbitrarily far back, but I picked 1960, and a gentleman named J.C.R. Licklider, who I picked him because he is perhaps a relatively less famous name in the history of the internet, but perhaps among the most important. So in an article in 1960, he wrote the following quote, and I'm going to read it to you just because I do find it so inspiring. "It seems reasonable to envision, for a time 10 or 15 years hence, a thinking center that will incorporate the functions of present-day libraries together with anticipated advances in information storage and retrieval. The picture readily enlarges itself into a network of such centers connected to one another by wideband communication lines and to individual users by leased wire services. In such a system, the speed of the computers would be balanced and the cost of the gigantic memories and the sophisticated programs would be divided by the number of users." So this quote still, as I mentioned, gives me shivers today. Maybe that tells you a little bit about me. But in a time when computers were room-sized, gigantic, maybe had the power of a modern-day $30 calculator, he and a few others were looking toward the future of the internet, perhaps a bit ambitious in terms of the time it would take, 10 or 15 years. But in 1962, he was appointed the first director of the Information Processing Technology Office at the ARPA, the Advanced Research Project Agency. And actually, he wrote some of the memos that led to, in 1969, the first packets traveling across the ARPANET, right? The first four nodes you see here depicted on the apocryphal back of the napkin at SRI, the Stanford Research Institute, the University of Utah, UCLA, and UC Santa Barbara. So four nodes in 69, this network grew exponentially. I mean, I think direct lineage, obviously, to where we are today with the internet. We could draw the internet on four nodes in 1969. I could have included a slightly more complex picture from 1977, and you would have all perhaps understood it. So today, we don't really know what the internet looks like. We know that it has 4 billion plus users on it. That's about 50% of the population of the world. 20 billion plus connected devices approximately on the internet today and continuing its exponential growth. So a stunning journey to get us to this point. I really do believe that the internet is one of humanity's greatest achievements. And we're perhaps right in the middle of it. We're not at the beginning of it, but I don't think that we're very close to the end of it. And I think that historically, we'll look back on this time as, again, one of the transitions alongside the Industrial Revolution and related things. It is the basis of essentially all human communication today, and it is the ultimate repository of human knowledge. We're taking it for granted, though, increasingly, I would say, as such. Increasingly, this is the 20 billion connected devices, it is the basis of sensing and actuation of our world. Paradoxically, however, and I think that this is where we're at an interesting transition point, the underlying principles that allowed the internet to achieve this massive, massive success over a relatively short time period may need to be revisited. And I might argue a little bit more strongly, do need to be revisited to allow us to take the internet and the applications that live on top of the internet to the next level. So the questions I'll start with are, what level of availability do we need for human communication? If this is the fundamental mode of communication increasingly, how reliable must it be? Similarly, what level of availability and security do we need for our human information store? Right? So if this is the repository of our knowledge, how reliable does this repository need to be? Before coming to Google, I had the good fortune of teaching undergraduate and graduate networking as a professor. And basically my first lecture every quarter or every semester started with the following. I talked about the deep principles that allowed the internet to be what it is today. Right? I talked about best effort, right? What the service model is in the internet. There are no guarantees about whether data will arrive. I talked about soft state. Useful for efficiency, the state that you maintain in your systems in the internet and networking in general, but not required for correct operation. And our protocols are fully decentralized. And this underlies essentially everything we do, BGP, OSPF, ISIS, TCP, IP, DNS. Right? And these things actually, the beauty of these protocols and the beauty of these ideas were what drew me to networking in the first place. Right? So I mean, I imagined a elements in the network coming up with no state, exchanging information with its peers, and in a short amount of time, becoming a fully functioning member of the internet. Right? How do you do that? Right? How do you make that work? Again, if you think about it, maybe we take it all for granted, but that is sort of stunning. And the internet grew as a result. Right? If I could take my potential internet device, connect it to any existing member of the internet, after a while, I was a member of the internet. We wouldn't be at 20 billion plus connected devices, 4 billion users of the internet, if it weren't for ideas like this, right? And the beauty of the protocols that got us here. Now, on the other hand, what are the implications of these deep-seated principles, soft state, decentralization, and best effort for the performance, predictability, and availability of the network, right, that we have built? So the question that I would ask is, what is the network product definition in such a world? If you start with best effort, you really can't say what the network product definition is from the perspective of the user of the system. What can they expect? So imagine that you are a software engineer and you are told that your DRAM accesses would be best effort. Most of the time, they're going to return in 100 nanoseconds, 60 nanoseconds. But 1/1000th of them would take a millisecond. And 1 out of 10,000 of the DRAM accesses would fail altogether. How would you write your code in such a world? Where most of the time, 60 nanoseconds, but some other times it's a millisecond or more, or perhaps it fails altogether. You can imagine that it becomes much, much, much more difficult to actually write robust code in this world. So in with the kinds of services that are running on the internet today, latency matters, availability matters, but not just in the best case. Now you can't say things are good most of the time, or things are good at the average. We wind up really caring about the tail of the distribution. What's happening at the 99th percentile, the 99.9 percentile, frankly, at the 4/9 or even 5/9 of the distribution. So how do we provide meaningful measures of network products and tie it to application requirements? A step in this direction, and one that we've pursued over the years, as have many across industries, software-defined networking. So what we're seeing is, how can you use software-defined networking as the basis for delivering some of these higher-level network guarantees that our services need? When the internet started, the thinking around distributed systems was in its very, very early stages. So again, 1969, 1965, early 70s, we didn't have the notion of leader election consistency protocols. Again, a lot of things that we might take for granted in 2020 hadn't even been thought of in distributed systems. So one question to ask and answer is, now, knowing what we know about constructing large-scale distributed systems, how would we revisit network design? This is not to say that best effort, soft state, and decentralization go away. The question is, how would you enhance them? How would you meld them with some of the advances in large-scale distributed systems construction to build an even better network? How do you, within an autonomous system, at least, right, within one organization, leverage centralized state where it makes sense? So now imagine, rather than having an element come up and learn from its peers what it needs to know in order to become a fully functioning member of, let's say, a data center network, that it comes up and it actually gets told the full configuration of the network and its role within it. Now, that's a much less glorious problem. It's much less difficult, but it actually turns out to be, yes, simpler and more robust in terms of performance, in terms of availability, in terms of manageability as well. So we can use this as the basis for moving from best effort to service level objectives and service level indicators, right? What are the measures of the goodness of our network? And what promises are we willing to deliver and stand by as the operators of the network, as the designers of the network, in terms of what applications can expect? All right, so at Google, what can we tell the large-scale replicated database system? All right, we have a system called Spanner that seemingly violates one of the foundations of large-scale replication, the CAP principle. I won't go into what this means, other than to say, by having the network connectivity be sufficiently reliable where you don't have to think about long-lived partitions, you can actually get strongly consistent wide area data access. Right? So again, up-leveling what the network can do is all about up-leveling what the applications can do. Right? We don't live in a vacuum. Okay, so with that, let me put some of this in context with respect to how we do things at Google, how we see things at Google. Here is one external view of Google's network. So what you see with the dark circles, the larger dark circles, these are our various points of presence across the planet. Connected to one another by a large fiber plant. This is where we, in many cases, we have our own data centers. In other cases, we are in peering centers where we have our edge servers. The yellow circles represent our Google Global Cache, essentially our content distribution network that we use for YouTube and related properties. Okay, so our infrastructure, that's one view of it. Here is the software-defined view of it from the inside out. So at the core, we have data centers that host clusters of servers. Think of them as tens of thousands of servers interconnected by a high-speed local network. Name of internally is Jupyter. These data centers are connected to one another by a private wide area network called B4. Long story as to why it's called B4. Won't go into it here. But essentially, B4 is the basis for computer-to-computer communication at Google. Now, these same data centers are connected to our peering metros across the second wide area network that we have, B2. This is where human-to-computer interaction essentially takes place. Right? This is how users get to our data centers from across the internet through our peering metros. Our B4 is a software-defined network as well. I'll describe that in more detail in a second. And our peering metros run a system called Espresso. So while, of course, our connectivity to the rest of the world, the internet as a whole, is over BGP, right? That's the lingua franca for connectivity to the network. We actually back BGP up, as I'll show in a moment, with a software-defined protocol to optimize for availability. And of course, users then enter this network through these peering metros, winding up at one of our data centers, or perhaps terminating at a peering metro for the requests. So the pillars of SDN at Google, B4, our WAN interconnect, Andromeda, which I didn't show in the picture earlier, but it is our network virtualization stack. I'll describe that in a moment. Jupyter provides data center networking, and Espresso, which is our software-defined networking for the public internet. So here is an outdated view, because we have more nodes on it right now, of B4 Google's software-defined WAN. What software-defined means here is that we actually have a centralized traffic engineering protocol here. So we have baseline connectivity on standard routing protocols, but we actually have a global controller that keeps track of failures and communication patterns in real time, and then repaths through the network through a multi-hop protocol. So essentially, we are creating new virtual paths through the network from point A to point B in response to real-time communication patterns. while observing quality of service requirements. So we know that, for example, under failure, these are the applications that are most critical to have the bandwidth remain up for, but here's the other applications that we keep up most of the time. So in other words, we are able to differentiate, here is the 5-9s reliable paths, here are the 4-9s reliable paths, here are the 3-9 reliable paths. Interestingly, when we started before, now more than a decade ago, it was viewed as being a 1-9, 90% reliable copy network. So in other words, it was going to be the basis for just doing large-scale copies from one data center to another across the wide area network. And that was frankly the only way we could get it started in retrospect. Today, it actually delivers more capacity, growing more quickly, and with higher levels of reliability than our public network through the software-defined component. So in other words, this was a radical departure 10 years ago. Could this be built? Could it actually deliver requisite levels of availability in a centralized manner? And I think the resounding answer has thus far been yes. So here's a picture of the growth of B4, looking at it from 2013 to 2019, 7-year period. So this is January 1 to December 31. 127x growth that basically annualizes to, according to the math, exactly 99%. So this network has been doubling in capacity, and as I mentioned, is now serving more data bandwidth than our public network. We extended some of these SDN ideas to Andromeda, which basically allows us to deliver private networks on top of our underlying system using software as the basis for virtualization. So the basic idea is, in black, we have our internal network, top of rack switches connecting servers to one another. They're running in their own IP address domain. We're able to then layer on top of this physical network any number of virtual networks. So you see a green plane, a yellow plane, and a red plane. And the idea there is that they can get their own private namespace with a centralized software routing system that essentially allows each of the end hosts to do the right encapsulation over the physical network to the destination host. Right? So for example, in the green VNet, if I have a 5.4 address and I want to talk to another 5.4 server, as far as I'm concerned, I'm talking to another 5.4 server. The routing system, under central control, will know how to encapsulate packets at the edge of the network on a programmable packet processor that we've developed to be able to essentially send the data across the network to its destination on top of the underlying physical network. So critically, what SDN has allowed us to do here is essentially not require any updated hardware, redeployment of any new infrastructure to deliver the virtualization technology. Now, of course, if we, and over time, we perhaps get more capable hardware, we can leverage it. But the idea, and we do leverage it, in fact, but the idea here is that we have a large fleet, and we can't wait for retrofitting an entire fleet with new hardware capabilities to deliver new use cases. And the notion of having a high-speed, efficient, programmable packet processor under software control, central software control, to be able to layer this technology on top of the underlying hardware, making minimal assumptions about what that hardware can do, has been very powerful. So I talked about routing. But you can imagine that we use this for load balancing, layer 3 load balancing, for DOS detection and prevention, for access control lists, for a range of different network function virtualization techniques. Okay, so Google's data center network has been driven by the need for new capabilities. So essentially, we have a long history of wonderful partners that want to run services that just don't fit on current network technology. So there is an apocryphal story, again, going back to about 2001 or 2002, where we wanted a network of 10,000 ports, gigabit Ethernet, non-blocking. We asked industry what it would take to build such a network, and we were told that it was impossible. But again, we had applications, search, data processing, and others that said, we need a 10,000 port, 1 gigabit per second non-blocking network. So we set out to build it. Right? That was some of the naivete, I won't go through the history here, that's a whole talk in and of itself. Perhaps unsurprisingly, we failed a few times. Right? We tried to build our own network, and actually the first few dots on this graph, in some sense, were failures. In other senses, they were massive successes, because they enabled what you see in Watchtower in the center was actually our first in-house data center network, hardware, software, leveraging software-defined networking technologies for routing and otherwise, that delivered this notion of a high port counts, non-blocking data center switch, at that point actually at 10 gigabits per second, leading to Jupyter. Our current architecture, and the idea behind software-defined networking here is actually not just speed, not just scale, but evolvability. Again, from a capability perspective, our application developers hated the notion of saying, hey, we're going to take this cluster down, burn everything out, and put in a new cluster, come back in 6 months, please. And if you're in 20 clusters or 25 clusters, as our biggest services are, what that means is we're telling them that they have to leave a cluster all the time, every month. And again, when you're talking about something like search, ads, YouTube, that's not an easy proposition. What Jupyter allows you to do, again, with software-defined networking is essentially upgrade in place. So it's a living fabric. As you add new racks, you add new capability. As you take away racks, you then are incrementally evolving the composition of that cluster in place. So the goal is not just speed, scale, capability, but actually operational simplicity, to the point where these things can be evolving in real time and not forcing the applications to deal with the management headaches. Similar capability drives our most recent work on tensor processing units, TPUs. The idea here is that we have our own custom silicon for doing machine learning operations. But critical to this, and this picture just shows a subset of one of our TPU pods, is actually also the network interconnect, right, in the data center that allows each of these chips to be able to talk together at very high speed. In other words, one chip can't do the job for the machine learning things that we want to do. This is true of us, it's true of industry, but we're able to take it to a much larger scale than others because of the vertical integration that we can drive between the processing units, the servers, the storage, and of course, the network that drives all the interconnect. And finally, Espresso. For this audience, maybe of a particular interest, this is how we do software-defined peering. So I won't go through all of the details here, but at the highest level, the way to look at it is that we have these programmable packet processors that are running on every one of our servers, including at the edge of our network. So this is where we terminate many to most of our TCP connections from users coming into our network. What we're able to do is measure application performance on a per TCP connection basis. Okay, so this is a signal that we can then feed to a global controller. The signal is not used in real time, but essentially what we can do is figure out for users accessing our service from this part of the planet, from this subnet, and coming into this peering point, what kind of performance are they getting? What kind of availability are they getting? Are they seeing dips in performance? Are they maybe less available than we would like? This global controller runs real-time analysis, not second by second, but let's say at single-digit minutes, and then feeds the information that it gets to a local controller running at each of our edge sites. This local controller then pushes state to these same programmable packet processors that says, here's how you want to encapsulate packets. Basically, if you have multiple available options in how you get a packet to its destination, pick this one. Because based on the global signal that we have across all of our metros, this is the place that's going to likely deliver the best performance and the highest level of reliability. So then the packet processors mark the packets with a label that an MPLS, a standard MPLS switch that is providing the peering with our external partners can leverage to say, here's the actual egress for my packets. So this allows us near real-time control over our packet processing, leveraging these ideas of software-defined networking to both improve performance, but as importantly, improve reliability. So what I should have mentioned earlier is that the internet, depending on how you measure and where you are, delivers between 99% and 99.9% availability, right? 2 to 3 nines. It's these sorts of techniques that allows us to bump that up a little bit, even from an end-to-end perspective. Okay, so I talked about a few of the things that we've done at Google in networking over the years. And a lot of this is driven by demand for scale, bandwidth, reliability, and capability. But underlying all of this actually has been availability, right? So all these efforts actually, and why they're somewhat scary, is because they are going against, as Hussein mentioned early on, some of the norms. In other words, how we do things now, they're known quantities. Right? They deliver certain levels of reliability. When we change things, we are really essentially guaranteed to make things worse, at least for some period of time. When I talked about B4, originally it was envisioned as a copy network. That was the only way we could get it into production. Essentially what we said is, here's free bandwidth. Right? Use it to push your copies, but please don't count on it for anything important because it's not going to work. And that worked. And over time we were able to get it up, get it running, and then make it a little bit better. But we couldn't say, hey, here's the brand new network that no one's ever tried before with these crazy software-defined networking ideas and the central controller that's going to do traffic engineering in real time and create new routes for you whenever there's a problem. Like, everyone would rightfully say, you're crazy. Right? I'm not betting Google's business on this crazy new approach. So part of the lesson here is, how do you innovate while maintaining availability? Okay, so why fail last and fail least? Network is critical for correct service functioning. So it may be obvious to everyone in this audience, but without network connectivity, your service is down. Right? You can't get at it. But this is also true for power. Right? If you don't have power, your service is down. It's true for compute. If you don't have compute, your service is down. It's true for storage. So what makes the network special? Right? I claim that I think network is, and I'm biased, harder than the rest. Why is that? The network enables global communication and is hence inherently globally coupled. Our services are inherently globally coupled. So essentially the problem with the network is, and maybe it's a problem with our design for the network, I'm not sure, though I don't have a magic fix for you all here. Network failures are most likely to cascade, to spread, and to have widespread impact. The blast radius from the network is most likely to be unacceptably large. Power failures are unlikely to be unacceptably large. I mean, they can be bad. But what we worry about is the case where Google goes down. And it's unlikely that a power failure would take down Google, right? Or a compute failure would take down Google. So, and what's the backdrop for this need for higher levels of availability? As I've mentioned early on, internet increasingly hosts services critical to our day-to-day lives. Financial services, transportation, medicine, communication. So, you know, now imagine the internet being down for 5 minutes. We'd probably be okay. But now what about 8 hours? What about a week? I can guarantee that a week without the internet would be catastrophic. Not just because we couldn't get our news feeds, etc., and in real time. Now, so that's the backdrop. Highly reliable infrastructure is really hard. In other words, going from 2 nines of reliability. Remember, 2 nines of reliability, 99%, you score that on a test, you're pretty happy. You have 2 nines of availability, you're down 3.65 days a year. Not acceptable. So building highly reliable infrastructure is hard. It requires specialized expertise, and frankly, it requires experience. This was my point about the 90% available network getting better over time. The reason that we're able to, I would say the number one reason that we're able to build reliable infrastructure at Google is because we've seen a lot of failures. We've screwed up a lot, and we've learned from them. Right? So in other words, it's not that we come in smarter or not wiser on day one. We're wiser because we've seen it failed, and we've reacted to it over time. So again, this requires very specialized expertise, and in the end, high monetary costs. So by centralizing this expertise and applying best practices, the cloud can enable fundamentally more reliable infrastructure. In other words, I believe that the cloud providers can and do deliver greater reliability than any individual enterprise or service provider can. On the other hand, and this is the part that's very scary for me, is cloud failures are correlated. So millions of individual services are hosted on shared infrastructure. And if you have one bad failure, you take out millions of individual services. Whereas if you're an enterprise provider, well, it's not good if your enterprise goes down, but from, again, a society perspective, it's probably okay for one enterprise to go down. Whereas if millions of services and enterprises go down, that's a huge problem. So we've developed some design patterns over the years, both internally and for our cloud customers, for how we think about reliability. At the simplest level, so we divide our infrastructure into zones and regions. So zones are these, let's say, yellow circles, and regions are the blue outline clouds. Simplest services live in one zone and in one region. They're the simplest to build and maintain, they have the lowest cost, and correspondingly, they have the lowest level of availability. Basically, think of this as saying, hey, you go into a zone, think of it as a cluster, that's not exactly the right mapping, think of it as a data center, you bring up your service there, and you serve it from there. If best practices are applied to these single zone, single region services, we believe that you can deliver 99.9% availability, three nines, for your service. Next level of complexity is multiple zones, but in a single region. Here, you're going to introduce replication complexity and overhead. If your service is maintaining any state, and virtually all services do, you now have to replicate it across multiple zones. And you have to deal with that level of complexity. Now, your data might be inconsistent across zones, but the connectivity within a region is typically very, very good. The latency is typically very, very low. And hopefully, if we have our SLOs and SLIs correct, we can give you guarantees about that regional network as well, in terms of latency, available bandwidth to you. So you can likely run your multiple zone, single region service as if it were from a single zone, though at higher complexity and higher cost. We believe that you can get four nines of availability using this design pattern. And then finally, there's multiple zones and regions. Basically here, and this is how many services, internal services at Google are hosted, you're now going to face wide area bandwidth limitations. You're going to be facing speed of light limitations. Right? In other words, how long it takes for your updates to go across the planet is how long it's going to take your updates to go across the planet. It's the highest levels of complexity, the highest levels of cost, and commensurately, the highest levels of availability. We believe that it should be possible to deliver 99.999%, like less than 30 seconds of downtime, essentially, availability through this design pattern. But now we're telling this to our customers. What about us as infrastructure providers? If we're saying you can deliver 99.9% availability for your service, what does the network need to deliver within a single zone? Essentially, the way that we think about it is that the infrastructure services need to be 10 to 20 times more reliable than the service guarantees that we're providing. So if we think, hey, we're going to tell you you can deliver 99.9% reliable service in a zone, we have to be at least 10 times more reliable than that from the network side. We're not the only infrastructure. There's power, there's compute, there's storage, there's others. So we have to actually take it up even one more level. So essentially what we're saying is that critical zonal infrastructure has to deliver 99.995% reliability. Same argument applies to critical regional infrastructure. It has to deliver 99.9995% reliability. And I don't know about you, but when I start reading this many nines, I start thinking 100%. Like, I'm going to round at some point. It can't be down. Like, I can have nothing in my design, nothing in my budget that says I can be down. And I have to design for that from an upgrade perspective, from a failure perspective, and everything else. And then for global, you know, again. So this really starts looking like, for regional level, I have to be nearly perfect. So global network connectivity constitutes this critical regional service, and it has to deliver 100% availability. And yet, it's inherently coupled across regions, right? The network is inherently coupled across regions. So if you take down a portion of it, have you already broken your budget? So we had a tough time with this culturally, right? And this is also starting from where the internet is at. Best effort, soft state, the network's always going to be down for some of it's always going to be down, and that's okay. But for the applications that we were hosting, both the internal ones and increasingly the cloud-hosted ones, that wasn't okay. Engineers love metrics. And when you're talking about, you know, 5 seconds of downtime a year, it's hard to imagine what the metric is. Right? Did I have a bad second, and all of a sudden, I'm done for the year and I failed? Whereas if I say, hey, make this thing go faster, that's something people can get their head wrapped around. We went about this in the following way. essentially, after a number of fits and starts, we set out to measure and classify every minute on our network, and think of it as every minute on our network per network device as being either good or bad. And we set a high bar for what a good minute was, in terms of loss rate, in terms of overall behavior. And then we set out to automate the process of root causing the bad minutes. Perhaps not surprisingly to you, we had an enormous number of bad minutes to begin with. Right? And we weren't hitting any of our SLOs. So again, culturally, this was hard, because we were talking about going to 5 nines, 5.5 nines of availability, and we weren't anywhere close, according to our measures. The good news is, there were a relatively small number of items that constituted most of the bad minutes on our network. Further good news, with a year or two of dedicated work, we were able to fix those. And fix them permanently. And so this was awesome, actually. And this was a cause for celebration within the team, where we were able to take a whole bunch of things that were just always broken, but people took for granted. We were able to identify them, we were able to turn them into programs, we were able to fix them. People got promoted, right? That's always nice. So this was a big deal, I think, overall. So this was highly effective at eliminating repeat issues and preventing common escapes. And over the years, we got to a place where most of the time, things were great. Unfortunately, we still have far too many global network failures with never before seen signatures. So we wound up in a place where the sort of background rate of failure was okay, but way too many global failures, way too many things that either did take Google down, or a lot of Google down, or we, you know, felt the bullets whizzing by our heads, where we knew that while no one noticed externally, we were this close to having an outage. So complex systems fail in complex, hard to predict ways, and fixing the most recent set of issues that you had is unlikely to prevent the next global failure. So what's the path forward? I mean, this is hard. In the end, do we need 100 global independent networks? So I picked 100 as on purpose as an extreme target. 100% availability for these complex, inherently coupled infrastructural services with many dependent components that are upgraded weekly may be impossible. So, for example, we actually have had network infrastructure that we stopped upgrading. And it turns out that actually they had 100% reliability for years. If you don't touch it, it's not going to break. That doesn't work, though, for the vast majority of our infrastructure. So what we could imagine doing is logically and physically partitioning our network to fundamentally limit its blast radius, such that with 100 global independent networks, even if you take down a network, only 1% of customers would be affected. We've actually spent a lot of time on this problem. Building 100 global independent networks, or N global independent networks, is really hard. It's expensive, but more importantly, it's conceptually hard, it's operationally hard. We don't quite yet know how to do it, though we're continuing to actually push on this direction as likely a requirement for getting to where we need to get to. In parallel, however, we've extracted a set of design principles for highly available network infrastructure. Right? The idea here is that while we can't use past failures to predict how we're going to or enable preventing the next global failure, we can use the signatures of these global failures to extract design principles that we then communicate to the teams and then do design reviews around. Right? For our critical infrastructure, do you adhere to these design principles? How can we proactively find the next failure or the next coupling such that it doesn't happen? So with that, let me cover GCP incident number 19009. You can Google it or use your favorite search engine to find the details. We have a description of the issue online. So this took place in June. Again, it's, to my memory, one of the worst failures that we've had at Google. It took down a lot of Google for 3 to 4 hours total. So let's go through what happened here. And it was related to software-defined networking, in fact. So we have a range of network control servers, NCS for short, that essentially run the software, the S in our SDN. And they're partitioned across the world. So the network control servers were, and they're scheduled by a cluster management software, and they're upgraded by cluster management software. There are three bugs that had to come together to cause this outage. One bug configured our network control servers to be non-critical. Right, we have a bit that says, is the server critical or non-critical? This bug was introduced 6 or 7 years ago, actually, and sat latent for the whole period of time. On the evening of this failure, the engineer, who's very senior, very, very capable, and has been at Google the whole time, was horrified to learn that the change list he introduced in 2012 was one of the three that led to this. Of course, you know, obviously something in the history of time, but that was his change list. Second bug mapped the network control servers for multiple regions. I talked about zonal, regional, global. We have many network control servers. They're not all sitting in one cluster. They're spread across the planet. But the second bug, most recent bug, mapped them all to be one maintenance region. And then finally, there was a third bug. So these two were all fine. But there was a third bug that essentially said, hey, go upgrade all the servers in this maintenance region. And that upgrade was buggy. So essentially, it reset all those servers. Now, unfortunately, it reset all those servers in this one maintenance region that had almost all of our NCS. And that means that the brains for our network went away nearly simultaneously. Over the years, we've learned that we need to make our infrastructure fail static. What this means is that when your control fails, the data plane should stay up. Obviously, if your control fails, you can't continue to react to any real-time changes that are taking place, but the baseline data connectivity should be maintained. This design principle worked great for 99% of our protocols, except for BGP. Unfortunately, basically, the BGP-TCP connections went away, and the way that BGP interprets that is that the data plane is down. And so while the data plane was up and functioning near perfectly, all of our B4 private WAN routes went away globally within a few minutes. We have two backbones. Right? So in other words, I talked about 100 global networks. We actually have two very large global networks. And all the traffic did fail over to B2, our public network. But unfortunately, there were hidden dependencies in terms of quality of service. So in other words, we don't provision for all of our quality of service levels to fail over to B2. And this works okay when you're talking about a small scale failure or even a regional failure. But now imagine all of B4, a bigger network globally, failing over to B2. Applications running at the highest QoS classes were okay, but they had dependencies on other applications running at lower QoS classes. Eventually, after some number of minutes, those dependencies piled up and caused failures for our other applications as well. So essentially many, many of our services, especially our cloud-hosted ones, went away. Now, next issue, tooling to diagnose these issues had assumptions built in on network availability. Now, again, if big portions of our network go away, the tooling works great. When the whole network goes away, the tooling didn't work. And essentially, with the servers reset and our tooling not working, we had to restart from scratch. We had to bring our network control servers up globally, right across the planet, from scratch, using techniques that we'd never tried before. So what I want to say is, and I was there watching, essentially, the operational response was spectacular. And I do mean this. I mean, watching the team come together, they didn't have the tooling. They had to actually, on a Sunday, get on site to Google. Right, in some cases, physically running from the house to get on site, and then figure out how they're going to bring up all of our network control servers from essentially rebooted bare state to bring Google back up in 3 to 4 hours was way too long, but I don't think it could have gone any faster in terms of what the team was able to do. It's a really spectacular response. So what does this illustrate? System availability depends on many individual elements, and they're all important. What's your mean time to failure? Maybe this is one of the more obvious ones. How often does your system fail? How often does it undergo a global failure or a regional failure? Our mean time to failure is pretty good, but I would say that we do have these global events once every year or two. and that's probably not good enough. It's not terrible, and I'll talk about why in a second. Now, what's our scope of impact? For this particular failure, it was almost our entire network, and it could have been worse, actually. So in other words, there were portions of our network that didn't go down. What's your mean time to detection? Once you have a failure, how quickly do you realize that you have a failure? In the past, not for this one, in the past we've had failures where we've had to count on services to tell us about our network failing. That's the worst, right? Our network is showing green, it's all up, we think it's great, and then storage calls us up and says, hey, why doesn't the network work? Like that's a failure on our part. In this particular case, mean time to detection was a couple of minutes, and for something of this magnitude and complexity, 2 minutes is pretty good. Mean time to diagnosis. This is where we fell down. It probably took us 30 to 40 minutes to diagnose the issue, and that's because our tooling didn't work. And because the network wasn't up to a place where the tooling could work. And finally, and maybe as importantly as any of the others, perhaps more so, what's your mean time to mitigation? So once you've diagnosed it, how quickly do you recover? So on the one hand, I said, I'm not sure that our response could have been any better under the circumstances, but 3 to 4 hours is too long. So if we had had this exact same sequence and we were able to recover within, let's say, 5 minutes, we would have been badly upset. Like a 5 minute global outage would have been absolutely awful. And it would have been serious response internally, etc. But it would have been qualitatively substantially different than 3 to 4 hours, right? Especially since it could have been longer than 3 to 4 hours. Okay, so what do we learn from this and related issues? We've extracted some design principles that I want to share with you all here. I'll go through them in some detail. No global scope for our operations. And yet, maybe somewhat counterintuitively, you need a single source of truth. We have some design principles about how you apply upgrades. Right, so again, in the end, the trigger for this failure was how we upgraded our control servers, and how a bug in the upgrade process knocked out all our control servers. And then finally, the need for high resolution visibility into what the infrastructure, in this case, the network looks like. So taking them in turn, no global scope. You must have gradual rollout of any change with global scope. So if you're running a global service, you can't upgrade everything at once. And from a development velocity perspective, you actually want to upgrade everything at once. And then from a development simplicity perspective, you actually want to upgrade everything at once. You don't want to live with versioning. And when I say gradual rollout, I really do mean weeks for some of our infrastructure to be able to be safe. So now imagine that we have to actually live with multiple versions of our software, perhaps as many as three in some cases, running simultaneously across the fleet. But this is required. No global state instantly consumed by all global components. This is another one. From a development simplicity perspective, what you'd like to do is change a single config file, have everyone read it, and then you're off to the races. They all now see the new config. This is an anti-pattern from availability perspective. If you're going to change a global state, it has to be incrementally consumed over time and validated. Okay, no global scope, but a single source of truth. So again, one of the things that we've struggled with over the years is, what is the truth in, say, the network? Is it the compendium of all the state that is in every network element globally? Like, in other words, if you want to know what the network looks like, do you have to go ask every packet processor, every switch, every router in the network? Or is there a single source of intent, where the devices in the network are a reflection, in the end, of that single source of truth, intent? We've settled on the latter, that there is a single source of truth. It's a central repository for intended global state, and that you should and must check against that intended state and in pushing changes to your network. So these continuously evolving global network require these coordination points, and it's the central repository for intent that's the coordination point, for you to make sure that actually the network is getting to where you intended it to. Related to the first point, the upgrade process is critical. Input and protocol validation for defense in depth. So we, of course, at the scale that we run at, have lots of automation for upgrade processes. And what this says is that if you get an updated configuration, you should have some safeguards. You shouldn't blindly accept it, but every element is responsible for validating the contents of an upgrade and a config push. And if there's a question, be conservative. In other words, rather than accept it, actually that's when you say, stop the upgrade process, bring in a human being. Better to do that than to allow it to push through and cause an outage. Upgrades must be hitless, as are restarts. So again, this really pushes the need for in-service upgrades. When you are upgrading an element, the end user, the application developer, shouldn't notice. And then finally, there must be a fast, tested, scalable, and low dependency safe mode. And this is where soft state and best effort really come back to benefit us. So if you're going to have to bring everything back up from scratch, it should be it should be a push button. And maybe the system doesn't come up in the global optimum state, but it comes up. So in other words, can we get it back to 95, 99% functioning? We have a lot of wonderful real-time routing and everything else. Maybe we don't have that capability at first, but can you, in a tested, safe manner, bring the system up to baseline operational? We didn't have that at the time of this failure. This is in the end what we realized. Finally, high resolution visibility. Control plane and data plane health are not the same, and we've been hit by this over and over again. In fact, almost all of our bad outages have been at least partially attributed to confusing control plane health and data plane health. Essentially always, data plane health is good to great. It's the control plane that's confused. Slow wrecks can be particularly insidious. We have a lot of monitoring that looks for precipitous drops in something or other, massive increases in loss rate. But we've had some failures where the upgrade process, because it's gradual, slowly causes problems, actually. So this can, doing this gradual rollout can be interesting from the perspective of finding issues as well. And then finally, extinguish small fires quickly. This might be the, akin to the broken windows principle in economics. And actually, a lot of the work that we did to bring baseline availability up was really helpful here. The point is that if you're always accustomed to seeing a bunch of failures, it's hard to know when you're actually having a real problem. By saying, you know what, the baseline availability of the network is quite good. Like essentially, there should be, let's say, zero issues, zero unexpected issues. That makes it much easier to have high resolution visibility, because you can find the blips rather than expected background noise. So overall, I think what we're seeing with reliability, and certainly at Google, is that this is a first-class requirement along with security. Right? We have a dedicated security team. We have a dedicated reliability team. The point here is that when you're running something as complex as, say, Google or anything close, you can't get reliability by basically telling everyone, hey, please be reliable and deliver 100% reliability. Because in the end, that's not going to scale. So what's the common infrastructure? What's the common tooling? What's the common framework where we make it easy, quote unquote, for people to deliver the requisite levels of availability? Okay, so with this, I'll wrap up and take any questions that you might have. The network community has a very strong lore in scalability and programmability and performance. But I show this pyramid here in terms of how we think about infrastructure, in particular how I think about infrastructure. Availability is the base. All these other things can only stand on a very, very strong base. By the way, this is not where I started. You know, where I started, performance, right? That was the most important thing. But I've learned over time that a performance and efficiency, that's the dessert. That's what you get to have at the end when you've got all your other needs met and there's no need more than availability. No need bigger than availability. The network is the most likely cause of a global outage, certainly in our experience. So we have a critical responsibility, perhaps more so than others, to take availability very seriously. At the same time, best effort and soft state may need to be revisited despite the incredible role that they've played in the success of the internet. So what are the systems and principles that we as a community can adopt to approach 100% availability? Maybe in the end it's isolated independent networks. But also along the way, some of the things I pointed out along software-defined management, global circuit breakers, and others that you all might develop are going to be necessary for us to get there. Okay. Thank you.
The only one. Okay. Hi, Dave Temkin, Netflix. First and foremost, thank you for like this super transparent presentation. That was absolutely fantastic. I think everyone in this room absolutely learned something.
Thank you.
I've got a question. It's a little softer of a question than the technology because you talked a lot about what we need to do technology going forward. My question to you would be, what do you do? What do you need to do in developing and hiring people to work on that technology?
Developing the, what people, I'm sorry?
The people who you hire to work on that technology.
Oh, great point. I think that what I found is that the team naturally cares about impact working on important problems. So really, I think it starts with maybe some simple things. One is emphasizing the criticality of availability and reliability. In other words, you know, one of the things that we were able to do in response to this outage is sharing the actual impact on our customers of Google being down for 3 to 4 hours. And it was, frankly, heart-wrenching in a number of cases. But two, perhaps as important, is the metrics. I find that for availability, actually, I struggled with this, because how do I get to five nines of availability without being able to know what I can brag about, or what I've accomplished this quarter, or this year, etc. And I think there, the work I described in terms of classifying minutes as good or bad, classifying vulnerabilities as critical or non-critical, and actually then driving programs, funded programs, right, with staffing to drive that down and showing the improvement has been really, really important for developing that skill set to think in terms of how do I treat availability as a first-class metric that I go after day in and day out.
And when you say staffing, how do you find the staffing to work on these initiatives?
Good question. I guess that hasn't been as large a concern for us in that, frankly, it's the same software engineering team and the reliability teams, the SREs and the network operators that we've always had. In other words, the skill set hasn't been vastly different. It's a mindset. I find that if I look to myself, you know, initially early on in my career, security and availability weren't things I wanted to think about because that would work out. So maybe many engineers, or at least maybe I'm casting myself on it, are optimistic. And then I think it's just with sharing the experience, perhaps, really just says that actually you need to think about this 0.01% case, or what if this bad thing happens. I don't think that it's so much finding them as training them and working with them.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Question over here. I think he was there first.
Oh, great. Sorry.
Steve Kamen, just some random analyst dude. I'm going to try and articulate this. I've got hundreds of software-defined layers that are operating there, and we're talking about the reliability of that, and that makes some sense. On the other hand, down at the physical layer, the hardware you're running on, if I step back and look forward a couple of years, I've got a very limited number of web-scale players, cloud players, you know, we might throw Cloudflare into that mix, and that's the only physical hardware that's running all these hundreds of software-defined networks, and these start to become very, very large points of failure in and of themselves. And I know you've thought about it, but how do you handle the problem at that next layer down of just simple hardware diversity, which in the old internet was available just by default and through chaos, and how do you go from there?
Yes, it's a great question, I don't have a perfect answer to it. What I will say is that independent of cloud, it is absolutely the case that we're having consolidation in the hardware space. So it's our responsibility as a community, certainly our responsibility as cloud providers, to ensure that there is a vibrant community of hardware providers where we can maintain that diversity. That's something that we think about. In other words, when we think about how we build our network, we're not thinking, hey, who do we think is the cheapest, or who do we think is the most capable, or who do we think has the best software? We do think about the diversity question that you're raising as well, because we're thinking about infrastructure over a multi-decade period. So I don't know what the minimum number is. Is it 3? Is it 10? Is it 20?
I guess even there, if I've got, you choose a multitude of suppliers, but your network as a hardware thing becomes a unit of one. Facebook's network becomes a unit of one. AWS is a unit of one. Azure, GCP, and a couple other players, and we're done from a capacity perspective.
And so it's our job, for sure. Hardware elements are failing all the time in our network. And it's our job to characterize that, and it's our job to build our network to make, in the end, make that transparent to the services. And I'm not saying we're there yet, but actually that is something that we and the other cloud providers, I can say, are making progress on.
Hi, Tony Tauber, Comcast. Sort of 2.5-part question. One, going in the other direction, first one is with this analysis tool that you mentioned, like analyzing every component and like how it failed and how often. If that's something that you have that you could share, I think the community might be, you know, the better for it. And then number 2.5 is going in the other direction from the previous question was what looks at the higher layer stuff, the control plane that you talked about in the detailed case that you mentioned, and then what, you know, would it have found, would that analysis tool that you just talked about have found that higher, you know, control layer problem? Those are, you know, the trickier parts than the hardware often we find.
For sure. Great points and great questions. So taking the first, our analysis tools are currently not real time. They're post facto. So that partially answers your second question. I'll get to your second question in a moment. Our tools are essentially what you can think of them as doing is joining disparate data sources together and joining them based on essentially a schema of the relational table, I'm putting relational table in quotes, of what our network looks like. So our tooling is not something that, frankly, we could open source, not because it's a big secret, honestly, and not because we think our tooling is just so advanced that we have a head start on anybody else. It's just very specific to our infrastructure, where our data lives, how we need to do the joins, what our schema is. What I will say is we do believe that there is benefits to normalizing how we describe networks as a community. So one step that we've taken in this direction is a system that we're actually just publishing in an academic conference called NSDI in a couple of weeks, Network Systems Design and Implementation, on a system called Model X that we use internally to describe our networks. We are considering open sourcing that to get to a lingua franca for how networks are described. In terms of the control plane work, so I answered the first part of your question in that no, our current tooling wouldn't help us find control plane issues in real time. However, we are extending, if you will, the tooling such that we can be looking at the health of the underlying systems and the applications underneath them in response to changes in the network. So basically, one way to look at it is if we had visibility into something bad starting to happen, one easy fix would be to have a system that can basically stop all maintenance operations. No questions asked. It's not like, hey, do I maybe stop, not stop? No. In other words, you can only proceed if this system is allowing you to proceed. We are building and have deployed not the full version, but a version of this to help with the control plane issues that you're pointing to.
Hi, Chris Woodfield, Salesforce. You had a slide that had a beautiful photo of a TPU farm, which had me wondering, to what extent are your SDN controllers able to leverage machine learning at this point? Is it, and if so, can you talk about?
Great question. I would say that this is something that we're absolutely working on. I think there's a lot of promise here, but the good or bad news is that we're still in the early stages. In other words, I would say that we have some lower hanging fruit in terms of pattern recognition and time series analysis that we can do without needing the full power of a TPU to go after it. Hopefully in a few years, I'll be able to report on why we actually need the TPU to do some of the more advanced stuff, but we probably have some steps to take beforehand.
All right. Thank you.
Hi, Paul Zignoni from Wish. Regarding the response, you expressed a lot of appreciation how quickly your team was able to resolve such a difficult issue. And I imagine with Google, the size of Google, that you have like a 24/7 knock around the world. But you also made mention of people running in from home.
Yes, because our tooling didn't work and they had to actually get to the one room on site that had access to it. This was a failure on our part.
So my two-part question for you is, how do you make that balance in terms of staffing? How much you need people to be either on call or to be in offices you know, on that rotating basis? And second, does an event like this change your opinion of that?
We have a team, as you mentioned, geographically diverse, on call 24/7. In other words, it's not a single team, it's a rotation. We think hard, I can say, this isn't my team, so I'm going to take a bit of liberty, the operational team. It's a world-class team. They're on rotation every 6 or 8 weeks, I believe, for a week. And it's, you know, not 24/7. It's either 8 hours or 12 hours, depending on the team. In this particular case, absolutely, they shouldn't have had to physically be on site. It was a Sunday, and again, this was an emergency. And no one, by the way, I think the nature of this team is such that no one was upset by that. Like, the postmortem wasn't, oh my goodness, why did I have, I mean, we need the tools to work, so there's no question about that, but no one was saying, I didn't want to go into the office to get this global outage fixed. So I would say that no real change in terms of the seriousness or the staffing required here. We already had that in place. We certainly don't want to see an outage like this again, and we certainly want the tooling to work like it's supposed to in the future.
Great, thank you.
Rüdiger Volk, Deutsche Telekom. I wonder about the potential impact of snafus happening in the global external internet. Like, well, okay, very simple example, the old Pakistan Telecom thing, or some mess up in the DNS infrastructure.
Yes.
I could imagine that, well, okay, that kind of impact is somewhat limited by the fact that Google is talking to most customer bases fairly directly, but nevertheless, kind of quantifying the potential impact?
It's a great question, one that's near and dear to my heart, so thank you for asking it. I'll take my Google hat off here saying that vulnerabilities in DNS and BGP in particular are something that I'm quite concerned with, and actually I'm and my team are doing some work in the space directly from the perspective of improving the external state. Because as much as I talked about the societally critical services and infrastructure that run on the internet, we do have some rather gaping holes with respect to overall external reliability. Yeah. Thank you for the question.
Hi, I'm Kat from ServPac. What's your take on out-of-band networks so that engineers don't have to drive to fix the problems?
Yeah, good question. So this would have required an out-of-band network to the person's home. So in other words, it was a Sunday, the person was at home. Ideally, they should have been able to fix this. But again, this was think of it as a third global network that Google has, rather low bandwidth, that we couldn't have extended to everyone's home. So in this, the out-of-band question is a more exciting one in general, but for this particular one, I don't think that there's any practical way that we could have gotten out of band to everyone's home. It's a physically secure, separate network for the tooling.
Thank you.
Okay. Great. Thanks all.